This video is about how to control the pure photonics tunable lasers through an RS-232 interface. We expect that customers initially will want to use our GUI or our command line interface to communicate with the laser, but eventually they want to move forward and integrate the laser functionality within their system or within their test setup. And to do that, they will have to set up their own serial interface and provide the commands that are appropriate for that. This video wants to show the basics of that. First of all, the ITLA has a standardized communication interface. It's a multi-source agreement, which is an industry source agreement, and you can find the basics of that in the on the OIF forum. So www.oifforum.com. Go to Documents Implementation Agreements. Then there's a list, and go to the tunable laser implementation agreements. And now you can see there is the OIF ITLA MSA 1.3, which is the latest tunable laser ITLA agreement, and there's also a micro ITLA agreement. The micro ITLA agreement for the communication interface refers back to the ITLA. So the most relevant document is the ITLA MSA. Within this MSA, if you go to section 7, you can see the electrical interface. Let's go there. And so you can see that there is an TX and an RX pin and a ground pin that control the communications. This is a low voltage RS-232. So even though the physical interface doesn't matter too much for the implementation of the communication, it is important on how you set up your physical interface. And so you can't talk directly from a PC to this unit, because the PC RS-232 has levels of plus 15 and minus 15 volts, whereas the LVTTL RS-232 has level 0 and 3.3 volts. So you have to have a communication interface that provides a low voltage DTL. Within this implementation agreement, if you go to section 9, I believe, or section 8 first, you can see how the communications build up. So the communication with the host sends 4 packets to the ITLA, and the ITLA responds with 4 packets. So there's a handshake agreement, and the host is not supposed to send the next 4 packets until it has received the 2 packets. So you do not want to have colliding packets. And so the way the packets are built up, so the host to module and the module to host, is that there's a checksum and there is data. There is a couple of other fields which are not that important, but you should take a look at it. But so on the top one, figure 8.1.1, is the comment that is being sent to the ITLA, and on 8.1.2 is the comment that's sent back from the ITLA. There's a checksum in place, and the checksum is explained in this section here. The comment interface is a little bit more complicated, but essentially it's built up out of 4 bytes. The first part of the byte of the first byte already has been set by the checksum defined in section 8.1. Then there is on bit 24, that's the last bit of the first byte, the indication if it's a read or a write when we send the packet to the module. Then the second byte is the register number that we want to address, and the third and fourth byte is the data byte. Typically, when we do a read, only the register number matters, and the data bytes are empty. If of course you write, then the data bytes contain both we want to write to that register. The information that comes back from the module, again, is the checksum with some other bytes. Status in bit 24 and 25. And then again on the return packets, the register that was being addressed and the data, or the response from them from the module in the data byte. So it's a very structured approach, and it just means that we can very easily set it up. Now we have provided software to more easily use this. So if you go to the Pure Photonics website, www.purepurenics.com, and you go to a support section, then at the bottom of the page there's some application integration examples. We have an example in LabVIEW, in Python, or in C-code. I would say the Python example is what we use on a day-to-day basis, so that's the most mature. The LabVIEW example is fairly immature. We have no LabVIEW license here, and this LabVIEW example has been made during a trial period. So we are aware there are some errors here, but it's a good starting point. And the same for the C example, though that has been verified. So you can just click on the Python example and it will download, and we'll go to that. So it's a complicated code, but we'll go through it in some details. So all the registers are some of the registers are defined. These are just constants. Then we look at the connect statement here. Essentially, we're trying to connect at the desired baud rates, unless there is an error, which means that we would be sending back an error signal. If there is a serial connection on that port, but it doesn't communicate, or if there's a serial connection on that port, we try different baud rates to find out at what baud rate we have a response from the unit. And so after that, we'll either return the connection, or we will send an error bit if there's no response at any of the baud rates. The central communication command is the ITLA command. It takes the communication interface, which was returned by the ITLA connect. It takes the register, the data, and a read-write. First of all, what we're doing is we are implemented the queue. This is not inherently needed, but if you have a multi-threading applications where commands can collide, you do want to make sure that you hold back a command until you have completed the handshake for the previous model. Otherwise, you run into problems. So that is what the first part is about. Then, if we are reading it, we send the commands and we get a response. And we break it down into different bytes. We check the response if it's a pending bit or if there's an error bit, or if an AE. If the response is an AE, which means that, for example, when we get a string, we can't get it back in 2 bytes. That means that we are getting it back in like 4 or 8 or 10 bytes. It means that we have to poll the units separately, but the module always knows that you're polling for example, the serial number. So that's a special mode that we need to approach. Otherwise, we're returning the data. If it's a write, we do the same thing. We set a command, but of course, we have no issue with AEA, and so we can just return the data that comes back, which is supposedly the comment that we send, the data we sent. So that is kind of the core of the communication. When we go to the send command section, essentially what we're doing is we're writing the 4 different bytes to the unit. Very simple. So essentially we're sending 4 different bytes with start and stop bits to the module. The receive response is that we're checking the incoming queue, and we wait until we have 4 bytes that are incoming. If the time exceeds the 250 milliseconds, we'll give an error back, and the data return is FFFF is 65535. So in case that we are getting 4 bytes, we're gonna read all those 4 bytes. Unless there's communication with problem with communication, we'll get an error message. We'll check this checksum, which is calculated above, And all, if the check term is okay, then we return the bytes. So this is a fairly simple approach. Checksum is a standardized structure here, also no problem. The one thing that is not included in this program is error resolution. We typically don't, but if the communication interface can get confused, and in that case, for example, we can have sent 4 bytes, but the unit only has received three bytes and is waiting for this last byte. And then if we send 4 bytes again, it received the first byte of those 4 bytes, but then it receives the next 3 bytes and it keeps confused. So if you get out of sync with the model, you might want to send the zero command a couple of times until you get a response, 4 bytes response. So I would send up to 6 zeros, and then if you don't get a response after that, you're in trouble, but most likely you will get a response back, and then you are back in sync and you can continue. So this is how we are communicating with the tunable laser. It's fairly straightforward, and you need to make sure that you are addressing all the right characters. Going back to the MSA document, all the registers that are being addressed, that are addressable, are listed in this table. So you can see all of the power settings, frequency settings, all of that. There are a couple of additional settings that are not in the MSA that appear to be special or specific, and those you can find in our operating guide.